What's up, guys? My name is the J-Man, and welcome to my sequel. Oh yes, this is what I've had in the works, in my documents, when I've said, oh, stick around to the channel, there's going to be something amazing happening. This is what I've been talking about, a podcast. Yeah, I know, I'm no good with words, but hopefully we can learn together. And I guess I'd love to show you my opinions on everything to do with superheroes on screen. I don't really deal with comics. But thankfully, because I'm no good with words, I've got a co-host. Oh yes, I have.
Yes, you do. This is Ryan, aka Silva Productions, aka Silva Gaming. And, you know, we're here to talk about superheroes, so let's do it.
Yeah. And my oh my, we've started on a great week, haven't we?
Yeah, we have, actually.
A very busy week, should I say.
So many new things, yeah. It's crazy.
We recently had DC Week over on the CW network. We don't have that in the United Kingdom. But I still watch it on Putlocker. We had DC Week. We had all these teaser trailers from Brazil Comic Con, should I say? Hopefully that's right. But it came from somewhere.
I know the Spider-Man Homecoming one was on Jimmy Kimmel.
Oh yeah, okay. Spider-Man one came on Jimmy Kimmel. Guardians of the Galaxy came at Brazil Comic Con.
Yeah.
Just amazing. And, well, 2017 is going to be a year I'm never going to forget.
Me neither. It's crazy how many movies they've got coming out. And mainly Marvel. And, I mean, DC too. They've got a couple of movies coming out. Wonder Woman and
Justice League.
Yeah,
see, wow. It's coming so quick. Justice League already. Establishing all those characters. But we're not going to get onto Justice League, because we'll save that for another episode, another rant. But since we're on the topic of teaser trailers, let's get into both of them, shall we say. And let's start with a friendly web crawler, Spider-Man. Spider-Man Homecoming, the trailer came out on Jimmy Kimmel like a week ago, should I say.
I think it was a couple of days ago, yeah.
And the question right off the bat was, did you enjoy the trailer? Was it a good trailer?
I mean, looking at it now, like, I enjoyed it because, you know, who doesn't enjoy Spider-Man, you know? Going way back to the originals with, who played the original?
Tobey Maguire,
there you go. The originals with Tobey Maguire, then you had Andrew Garfield. I feel like I'm missing someone in there, but it doesn't really matter because now we've got Tom Holland playing Peter Parker in Spider-Man.
Oh, don't you worry. You're not forgetting anyone. Those were the only two that really played Spider-Man on the big screen. I mean, both of them were, like, praised for their roles, but in two different ways. Andrew Garfield, you can argue, was the better Spider-Man character. But for Peter Parker, you could argue Tobey Maguire was better.
But yeah, definitely.
Tom Holland, he's the best of both worlds, should I say.
I gotta agree with you there.
Well, from Civil...
I know, like...
Oh, go on.
Alright, like, I've heard, like, you know how, like, people compare Tony Stark to Robert Downey Jr., like, both Tony and Iron Man to Robert Downey Jr., and how well he plays the role. I've heard a lot of people say the same thing about Tom Holland and his portrayal of Peter Parker in Spider-Man, which is huge for him. I mean, because you've seen how far Robert's gone with the Tony and Iron Man thing, so.
Yeah, I mean, I looked at when Tom Holland was first cast in Spider-Man, I looked on Wikipedia to see what else he'd been in. He hadn't been in much, should I say, but he did play Billy Elliot. And that is a stage play here in England. So, you know, another British character in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Wow. Just repping for the country.
Yeah.
And yeah, our next question, we've probably already answered it. What did you think of Tom Holland's portrayal as Peter Parker / Spider-Man in the trailer?
Oh, I think he fit in perfectly. I think Tom Holland's the perfect Spider-Man / Peter Parker. And, I mean, it's great for Marvel that they cast him, because I think he's going to go far with the role and go far as an actor.
Yeah. To be honest, I think Spider-Man in the MCU will act as, like, the audience's reaction. So the audience will be like, what's going on here? And Spider-Man on screen will be like, what's going on? Infinity War comes, the audience will be confused, Spider-Man will be probably confused as well. He'll be like Deadpool, but except he won't break the fourth wall.
Yeah, I can see that.
Yeah.
I can see that happening, definitely.
And did you actually know that Tom Holland enrolled himself in a New York high school under a fake name just to get in character for Peter Parker for a few days?
I actually didn't know that. That's pretty cool. Do you know what college?
No, I actually don't.
No worries.
It wouldn't show up because he used a fake name.
That's true.
So yeah, that was all good. Now, let's talk about some parts in the trailer. Now, in the trailer, probably the most shocking thing was that his friend in the movie, Ned Leeds, and it's very interesting, Ned Leeds is the person in the comics who goes on to become the Hobgoblin, but in the MCU, they're doing things a bit different. But Ned finds out his secret identity. And normally, in a Spider-Man movie, we're supposed to keep it secret. Maybe the love interest knows, but no one else. But yeah, Ryan, what did you think of, whoa, something different, a different direction?
Well, I mean, like with the Marvel movies, I know they tend to kind of stray away from the comics. And I mean, before now, I didn't know that Ned played the Hobgoblin. So, I mean, story-wise, I could see where this is going. Like, if they do pull the trigger on Ned and make him the Hobgoblin at some point in the series, I think he'll use this to his advantage, knowing that he's Peter Parker, and that'll make a great movie for the future.
Yeah, I don't think, for the MCU version of Ned, I don't think he's going to become the Hobgoblin, to be honest.
I mean, I can see, like, I can see that, but, like, you never know, especially with Marvel. Like, they're pulling rabbits out of hats from everywhere, really.
Yeah, the opportunity's there, but as Tom Holland has previously said, he's signed on for 3 Spider-Man movies and 3 other Marvel appearances, so I doubt they'll go for the Hobgoblin route. But it's an option. They're throwing out different options, which I like.
No, I mean, like, especially with the Hobgoblin thing, like, I just looked up, the original Hobgoblin was a man who went by the name of Roderick Kingsley, and, like, going through here, it says here that Kingsley brainwashes Ned to act as a stand-in on many occasions and fool the underworld into thinking that Ned is the Hobgoblin. So, I don't know, maybe they'll introduce Kingsley later on in one of the later movies, and then they'll have him brainwash Ned and act as a pawn in spite of actually being the Hobgoblin, which he isn't.
That's an interesting route. But we never know. We'll have to look to the future. I mean, the sequel's already been announced. 2019. Yeah. I mean, that's a long way away.
It's a pretty bold move, too, because, I mean, like, I know, you never know for sure when the movie's going to actually be released, and the fact that they've already given out a release date is just absolutely crazy.
I know, and they haven't even gotten a response from the first movie. Like, what if it flops? But I doubt it will flop after this trailer.
Yeah.
And after Civil War as well.
Like, you never know, yeah.
Well, yeah.
I mean, you never know. Well, like, because with trailers, you had Batman v Superman, who everyone thought was going to be a good movie, and it turned out to be a flop. So, I mean, we'll see when Spider-Man Homecoming comes out.
Well, from the trailer of Batman v Superman, off topic, I didn't think it was going to be a good movie. After I saw Doomsday, I thought, ah, it's over.
I mean, like, I get that because the way they portrayed Doomsday was kind of eh, for lack of a better word. But, I mean, like, I don't know. It still had some kind of, like, it just gave off some vibes to me that I thought it was going to be a good movie. Until I eventually saw the movie where I was asleep for half of it, so, you know, that's how that panned out.
Yes, and for the second episode, because we're coming to the close of 2016, we'll give all our views on everything superhero related, and also, like, ranking every superhero film of 2016 from, what, last place to first place. We'll say all of that next week, and I can talk all about Batman v Superman. It'll be an open floor,
yeah.
Because I have a lot to say. But yeah, well, we've lost topic. We were talking about the Spider-Man Homecoming trailer, weren't we?
Yes, we were.
And the next question I've got here in my notes is, well, what role do you think Michelle, which is Zendaya's character, what role do you think she'll play in the film? I mean, in the trailer, she looked like... In real life, she looks pretty. But in the trailer, she just looked weird. And like, yeah, a loner.
It was a complete 180 from what she actually looks like in real life. And I mean, like, her role in the movie... I know Michelle is a new character introduced, right?
Yeah, new character.
Michelle and the other girl. I can't remember her name right now.
Pull it up for you. Liz Allen.
Okay, like, I know these are new characters being introduced, so I don't know where they're trying to go with this, but I mean, I'm kind of anticipating to see what they do from here and how they kind of go forward from this. In terms of Zendaya's character in the film, I don't know, for some reason I feel like she'll play like a Flash Thompson type character, except she's a girl, to kind of, I don't know, like, for some reason, like, the way she was dressed and the vibe she was giving off, calling them losers, I don't know, I feel like she'll be the Flash Thompson of this movie.
Yeah, when I personally think, right, I'm gonna put a theory out, like, because she's weird, she's a loner, probably she has no friends, I'm assuming, maybe... By the third Spider-Man movie of the trilogy, she'll turn out into the Zendaya we know, she'll be all glamoured up. But my theory is that her real name isn't, like, Michelle, because she looks closed in, like I said, loner, stuff like that, and supposedly she's really smart as well. So, what my theory is that Michelle's not a real name, her real name is going to come out soon enough, is Mary Jane, because I still think she's going to be Mary Jane. They need a Mary Jane there somewhere, but I think Mary Jane.
Yeah, I see that. I see where you're going with that. But I mean, like, we'll see how it pans out, of course, obviously, when later on when the movie comes out.
Yeah, I'm trying to look up Liz Allen. She's actually not she's new to the movie universe, but in the comics, she's not new. She was already Peter Parker's love interest. And I thought I saw something here about her being maybe Norman Osborn's daughter, or related to Norman Osborn.
Elizabeth Liz Allen, also known as Elizabeth Allen Osborn.
Yeah. Yeah, she's related to Norman Osborn, which is another door opening, if you could say.
That's true. Yeah, that's definitely true, bringing in someone to play Osborn.
Yeah. And our next topic in the notes, Peter Parker and Tony Stark's interaction. What are your thoughts?
I think they complement each other very well, especially in the movie trailer, the part where they were in the car and he went to hug him and he was like, oh, this isn't a hug, I'm just opening the door for you. I thought that was pretty funny. And I think they'll play well together, especially considering that, you know, how well Robert Downey Jr. has grown, how like how far he's grown as Iron Man. I think he'll try to mentor Toby. Jesus, Tom, and make him the best Spider-Man out of all of them.
Yeah, and I noticed the. I think I know roundabout when this takes place. This takes place not after, but probably during Civil War. And there's a nice little continuity where Tony still has the black eye he had in Civil War. And I think that's just him dropping him off during Civil War. And one part I liked about it was Tony's line in the trailer. He was like, "Don't do anything I would do. And don't do anything I wouldn't do."
I wouldn't do, yeah.
There's a thin line. There's a grey area that you have to follow. And I like that because... And there was another line by Tony saying to Peter, I know school sucks, but, you know, just study. And I know where he's coming from because at an early age, Tony Stark's parents died. He had to take over the company. He had to basically become an adult real fast. And I guess He doesn't want the same thing happening to Peter. And look, I don't think he doesn't want to be a father figure. That's no, the whole hug thing. But it's like him trying to, you know, play as a father figure type role in the movie.
Yeah.
And at the end of the trailer, we got a nice little tease, Spider-Man swinging, and then with Iron Man. So, I don't know. I know that they'll probably team up, and I think our next question in the notes will answer that. Spider-Man Homecoming showed off some villains. There's three villains in total in the movie. There's the Tinkerer. Now, the Tinkerer goes way back in the comics. He's the one that just fixes the villains, like, weaponry and stuff like that. There's the Shocker as well. No need to explain him. I think we know who the Shocker is. And the main villain, the Vulture. Now, Michael Keaton has already been announced to play the Vulture, which is, well, in the trailer, it looked awesome. Yeah, but it did. What are your thoughts? Do you think he'll be a good villain?
I mean, like, we'll have to see, but, like, from what I've heard, he's done pretty well at playing villains in movies, so I think he'll fit the role well in this movie especially.
Yeah. Also, the Vulture has never been, well, it's never been shown on screen. So it's a good little change to the norm, to the Green Goblins, to the Doc Ocks, even though Doc Ock, the movie was in, was great. Spider-Man 2. Venom, flipping Sandman as well. It's a nice little change. And also, I like the updated look. Well, if you see the Vulture's look in the comics and the TV series, it's a bit feathery, should I say. But his look there, it's really, really cool. And Tom Holland's already said, like, the first time we see the Vulture, it's like a horror movie. It's scary. So, and plus the tone of the film as well. I mean, it's going to be a nice little tone change.
Yeah, definitely. And, I mean, like, considering that they've cast the Vulture and Shocker as villains, it shows that they're trying to push away from the cookie-cutter villains such as the Green Goblin, Hobgoblin, Venom. So, I mean, like, in future movies, it'll be fun to see where they go from here. Like, I'm expecting to see maybe Carnage or... I'm just really hoping to see Carnage, really.
I think Carnage will be... I think in the third one, at least. Yeah. But if you do Carnage, then you've got to do Venom and Eddie Brock. And it just seems... If you do a movie with just those two, it could work. But how you're going to have to squeeze the symbiote, Venom, and then Carnage into one movie. I think that's all too much.
Maybe. I mean, yeah. That's, yeah, you've got a point there. But I mean, like, besides Carnage, you've got, you know, Kraven the Hunter, you had Lizard, who was in the last one. They introduced Rhino in the Amazing Spider-Man 2, but they never really went anywhere with that. You've got Mysterio, Chameleon, so many villains.
So many villains. Even the Kingpin.
Yeah.
You could integrate him with Daredevil as well from the TV series. Be a nice little blend. It will be fresh.
Yeah.
And also, the Kingpin's actor, Vincent, I can't pronounce his second name, but Vincent will be he's a great Kingpin, let's be honest.
He is, really, yeah. And I've seen him in a couple of other movies now, too, after playing Kingpin in the Daredevil series. So, I mean, it's good to see him, you know, getting these opportunities after playing such a prominent role in the DC, in the Marvel world. I said DC, I'm about it.
Ooh, trademark, copyright.
Yeah.
But one thing as well, I think I got from the trailer was, I think in the first scene when the robbery is going down, they were to open the vault to get the money, they were using Chitauri tech. And Chitauri was the extraterrestrial race in the Avengers. And I think that robbery includes the Vulture, Shocker, and maybe the Tinkerer. The Tinkerer may be giving them that tech. And maybe in the trailer, Michael Keaton, the Vulture, says, we've got to get better, you know. We've got to get better. So maybe that was a call of arms. Maybe the Vulture's the leader, the Shocker, the Tinkerer helps out. All those three are in the same boat, basically.
Yeah. I mean, in terms of them introducing the Chitauri tech in the movie, it's definitely going to link him to Civil War, not Civil War, Infinity War, which is coming up. So, I mean, we're going to see how it pans out in there. But yeah, definitely, I think the Tinkerer introduces the tech to the villains. And I know, like, if he has introduced the tech and the fact that they've made a new Vulture suit, I think the Vulture suit will have some sort of, like, Chitauri tech in it to make it grander in a way, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, we already saw from the improvement for the Vulture's outfit. I definitely think there's Chitauri tech in there.
They didn't show the Shocker in the trailer, right?
They showed the Shocker in the international trailer.
Oh, I haven't seen that one. But I'm gonna have to see that.
The international trailer is short. It's definitely shorter, but it shows more action and less of the Peter Parker in school. It's only like 1 minute 20 seconds.
Alright, I'm gonna have to watch that later on. If they are introducing the Chitauri tech, we'll have to see how far it pans out. Maybe they have the Shocker with the tech as well. But yeah, we'll see.
Yeah, that links in with our next note. How will this film link to the whole of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, as well as, or even, Infinity War?
I know in, like, past Marvel movies, they've kind of had walk-ins from other actors in the Marvel Universe, so, I don't know, maybe here and there in the movie, you'll see, like, I don't know, Ant-Man, or Thor, or someone here or there to kind of give it that vibe that, Peter will be joining the Avengers later on. But yeah, especially with the Chitauri tech and the new villains and the new movie, and you had, like, Tony Stark plays a prominent role in this movie, as well as he will in Infinity War. I just think that they're setting up, like, linking Peter Parker to the Avengers, which seems to be panning out pretty well.
Yeah, we got that vibe from the trailer as well, because I think it's Peter wants to prove to Tony and to, well, the world, basically, that he's good enough to become one of the Avengers. And we even said, like, Peter even said in the trailer, like, so is this like a tryout for the Avengers or something like that? Which, and Tony said, well, you're too young. You're too young. And he's treating him like a kid. And, well, even Tony, when the Vulture came in, said, oh, there's people who can deal with that, aka the Avengers. Well, one half of the Avengers. And Peter wants to go it alone, I guess, and wants to prove to everyone he can become one of the Avengers. And in terms of, like, linking it to the rest of the MCU, of course we've got Tony Stark, Iron Man, will probably have a little, maybe, appearance from Peter's friend from Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Captain America,
there you go.
Whoa.
Representing Brooklyn. Jesus Christ. I popped Brooklyn. When you said that in the movie. Where are you from? Queens. I'm from Brooklyn. I just fucking wiggled around like, my guy.
I can imagine. I can definitely imagine. But, yeah, probably. He's not, as the Russos confirmed, him dropping the shield in Civil War, that means he's basically not Captain America anymore. Because it makes sense. That was the third Captain America movie, trilogy over. He's putting down the shield. Probably pick it up again in Infinity War. But we'll see. And yeah, I think that's it for that. And yeah, we've already talked about, I know, about any other appearances. Now comes the last bit of the Spider-Man trailer. Do you have any potential post-credit scene ideas?
I have one. We know that Peter really wants to join the Avengers, so maybe in the post-credit scene, they'll show him kind of bugging Tony, like, oh, am I in? And then you'll have, like, an annoyed Tony just sigh and just say yes reluctantly, like, not meaning it, but just accidentally saying yes, and that'll just be the end for him, because now he let Peter join the Avengers. Something like that.
That's an interesting one, but I've had this from, like, since Spider-Man appeared in Civil War, I've had this post-credit scene in my head, and it really fits, because as a young boy, I watched Spider-Man the Animated Series, and two episodes stood out to me, and that was, of course, the Spider-Man and Daredevil episodes. Daredevil being my favourite superhero. So those ones stood out. I think Spider-Man and Daredevil are like proper good friends. So for a post-credit scene idea, I thought maybe Peter's in like a small quartz case or something like that. And the camera pans. Someone's talking. It's like a lawyer's talking, but you don't know who it is. Camera pans. It shows Matt Murdock, and then fade to black. And I think that would be a really good way for the movie universe to, well, link in to the TV universe. I mean, the Netflix universe have already mentioned all the things happening in the movies. The incident, the Avengers, the Avengers Age of Ultron. So the movies have to do the same with the Netflix series. I think that would be a nice little nod.
Yeah, definitely. I can see that happening with Daredevil and Spider-Man in the post-credit scene. And yeah, they have talked about it in the TV shows before. So, I mean, it'll be fun to see all these characters come up from Netflix to the big screen, especially people like Jessica Jones and Luke Cage. I know they have Iron Fist coming out soon. And not only that, but the villains as well. I know David Tennant played the Purple Man, and like ever since watching that, I've loved Tennant ever since I watched him as the Doctor.
Yeah.
And in Harry Potter as well as the villain, so he can play both the good guy and the bad guy really well, and he showed that in Jessica Jones when he played the Purple Man, and I think he just complemented the role really well. Unfortunately, he died, but like I mean. You never know with Marvel, like, he can come back some way. Probably will in the future. So we'll see how it pans out.
Yeah, the only problem with that is if the Netflix series get moved up to, like, the movies, then kids, younger audiences will be like, who are these characters? And they'll try and go on Netflix and watch them and realize all these shows are like 18 plus. So that's one thing to consider, I guess.
I mean, if anything, they'll make the move, like, if they do turn it into movies, they'll make the movies 18 plus as well.
Yeah, but if they appear in, like, say, Infinity War, which I think they probably will.
Yeah, that's true.
Then how is that going to work?
Maybe they'll make Infinity War 18 plus.
Oh, I wish. And I'm just in time as well. And yeah, that was the Spider-Man Homecoming trailer. If you have any other thoughts, comment them down below. But we both enjoyed it. I can't wait for Spider-Man Homecoming, I must say. I even rewatched Civil War and saw all the Spider-Man scenes. Got me even more excited. Moving on, because there was one more trailer before that. This time it was a teaser trailer.
Guardians of the Galaxy.
Volume 2. Yes. Guardians of the Galaxy, the first one, shocked us all. Because Marvel had this little technique, this little structure of them onto their movies. And then some of us were getting quite bored. I mean, Winter Soldier was awesome.
Yeah.
But Guardians of the Galaxy just shocked me. Like, from when it first started, I thought, is this really a Marvel film? It shocked the world. And now they're coming out with Volume 2.
Yeah, and I mean, I know with Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 1, I was more excited for the soundtrack than I was the actual movie. And the actual movie just blew me away. It was so good. But, I mean, like, in terms of Volume 2, I am way more excited for the soundtrack than the actual movie. Because I know in the first movie, they used music a lot to kind of interact with the audience and to interact with the storytelling. So, I mean, I'm just anxiously waiting to see how they do that with Volume 2.
Yeah, I can't wait. And the first question, it's not even what was the trailer good, because we both know it was good.
Yeah.
The first question is, what were the best bits of the trailer?
For me, anything with Baby Groot and Drax the Destroyer. Especially, I like certain scenes from what I remember. You had the button scene with Groot, and like the end scene with Groot where he got the button and he left, and then Rocket was like, oh shit. You had that, and then with Drax where, what was it, like, he was, what's his name, Star-Lord was being, read by that woman, and then she kind of exposed that he has feelings for Gamora, and then you had Drax, who was just dying of laughter. I thought that was pretty funny.
Yeah.
Especially seeing how Batista, like, you know, we've all seen Batista go from, like, this animal in the WWE to now a fun comedic movie star, which is a huge transition for him, and it worked, and I'm kind of shocked that it did.
Yeah, well, I say that if you give Batista the right role, he'll play it to an extraordinary level. I mean, when I watched Spectre, he was in Spectre 007. Yeah. It was okay. It was just a boss man who just beat him up and said no lines, so it kind of worked. But comedy role, Guardians of the Galaxy, it just works. And exactly the same opinion. I think the Baby Groot scenes, they were cute as hell. And when the toys come out, boy oh boy, I'm getting a Baby Groot. And of course the Drax scene at the end. The woman there, Strength, was called Mantis. Mantis, the Marvel character in the comics, coming to the big screen via the Guardians of the Galaxy. But yeah, I didn't know I did know previously from leaked information, but yeah, Mantis, showing everyone their deepest, darkest secrets, and obviously Drax having a laugh.
Yeah. We'll see how it pans out in the movie. Now, in terms of the next question, the search for Star-Lord's father, do you think Star-Lord's father will play a key role in the Marvel Cinematic Universe?
Well, this is a lot like Rey's father in Star Wars. And to be honest, in both situations, I don't really think they would. Well, forgetting Star Wars for a minute. I don't think Star-Lord's father will play that much of a key role in the MCU. I know in the first one, it was hinted at that his father worked with, I forgot his name, that blue man with the whistle.
Yeah.
And the weapon, worked with him, and I guess that guy was going to bring Star-Lord back to his father, I guess. But I don't think it's that big of a plot point. I guess it's just, in terms of a Guardians of the Galaxy movie, I guess they need a plot to follow, and they don't really need a plot per se, but I think this is just for the plot. I don't think he'll really have that much of a key role in the MCU.
Alright, I mean, in terms of the first movie, I know, like, there were a lot of rumors that the Collector was Quill's father. I don't know if that's true or not. Didn't look into it, but like I thought, like if they do introduce him in this movie as his father, like you said, I don't think he'll play a prominent role. As a matter of fact, they probably won't even introduce him. Like you said, they'll just keep it a storyline, like he's looking for his father and he's going through all these adventures and this and that. I feel like that's the way they should go, and that's how they should just keep the story going and create more movies in the Guardians of the Galaxy brand.
Yeah, and that's an interesting point as well, Peter Quill's father, because in the comics, his father was actually Thanos. But, dropping facts down, just like that. But, I guess when I read Wikipedia, when I read IMDb, his father's already been cast, and it's just a regular human being. So, I don't think they'll go with Thanos this time. But yeah, I don't think he'll be that prominent. Can't really be too sure, to be honest. And next question. Will there be any crossovers with other Marvel superheroes?
I can't remember, but I feel like I saw Thor in one of, like, I don't know, I might have been a dream or something, I can't really remember right now, but I think Thor would be, out of all the Avengers, I think Thor would make the most sense to show up in this movie, because they are in the galaxy, and I don't think, like, Captain America or Iron Man have any business, you know, thousands, like, millions of miles away on a different planet. Thor, on the other hand, who is a god, can just travel around like that, so... I mean, you never, I think out of anyone, I think Thor would be the one to show up the most in this movie and kind of link them to the Avengers and everyone else.
Yeah, I think that's along the right lines. I just kind of worry, I guess, because there's going to be Thor Ragnarok this year as well. Yeah. So there's that as well, but it would make the most sense if Thor was in this movie. And especially if, say, the Guardians were going to go back to the Collector, and then Thor, I think some Asgardians came to the Collector in the Dark World and gave him the Aether, which is one of the Infinity Stones. So maybe Thor will come back to the Collector, and not trying to get it, but to just like get it and put it into a more secure area, so Thanos can't get to it. Because they did hint at that silly little 4-3 promotional video that he's trying to track down this blue man who likes sitting in a chair.
Yeah, okay, I can see that. I mean, speaking on Thor Ragnarok, I'm looking at the cast here. I know, like, in the comics, Ragnarok was the end of the world, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So, I mean, if they do use this to set up for Ragnarok, thinking about it, like, Earth is still there in Guardians of the Galaxy, right?
Yeah, that's still there.
Alright.
But...
because, like, the way they've set it up, like, I thought for a brief moment that, you know, Earth is gone, so maybe they wouldn't be able to set it up, but if it is there, then, yeah, they'd be able to set it up. And I'm looking right now at the cast of Ragnarok, like, they're star-stacked right now. They've got Chris Hemsworth as Thor, Tom Hiddleston as Loki, Jeff Goldblum as Grandmaster, Carl Urban as Scourge, Mark Ruffalo as the Hulk, Benedict Cumberbatch coming back as Doctor Strange, and Sam Neill, who is cast in an undisclosed role. I mean, it's pretty funny, because I know, like, looking here, Sam Neill and Jeff Goldblum were, and here's a fun fact, Sam Neill and Jeff Goldblum were both in Jurassic Park. Yeah. I don't know, I just thought I'd throw that out there.
It's alright, we're fact dropping right here, so it's alright. You can have one, I can have one. But that makes the most sense out of everything. And our final point of this trailer, of this whole movie, will Thanos make an appearance in the film? Because in the first film, he made a surprise appearance. I didn't even expect him. But will he make another appearance in this film?
In terms of, like, big appearances, I don't think so. But, like, small appearances here and there, especially in the end where he'll probably get up and, like, I know in the post credits of the last movie, he got up and he said that he had to take business into his own hands, right? Something like that?
Yeah, that was Age of Ultron, yeah.
That was Age of Ultron, alright. So, like, in terms of this movie, like, they'll show him, like, a little bit here and there trying to gather Infinity Stones and, like, wreak havoc. I don't think he'll play a big role in terms that he'll be the main villain, but he won't actually show up. They'll send someone else. Do we know who's playing the villain in Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2?
No, I don't think a villain has been cast per se. I know Peter's father's been cast, but that's about it. I'm not sure. I'm not looking at the Wikipedia page, but knowledge knows. I know that, like, no villain has been cast. And no villain has been named. Yeah.
In terms of that, then, I think Thanos will be the main villain in the story, but he'll send his goons to act as, like, not, like, smaller villains, but, like, main villains in terms of the story. Like, you get what I mean? Like, Thanos will be, like, the big picture, and then he'll send these other guys to be, like, to occupy the Guardians while he's out there scavenging, looking for these Infinity Stones to take over.
And also, we can't forget Gamora is the adopted daughter of Thanos. So I still think he'll play a role in there. I don't know if he'll make an appearance like he did in Guardians of the Galaxy. Yeah. But he'll still be there, and maybe, like, a subplot is, like, he sends out his goons to try and get Gamora back. Or something along those lines. Or try and get revenge against Gamora. One of those things could be happening. But, yeah, Thanos is, like, his presence will still be felt in the movie.
Yeah, definitely.
And, yeah, wow, we got through that in 45 minutes. All that trailer talk. Wow.
And time goes by when you're having fun.
Yeah. And fun, whoa, we haven't even got to the... we haven't even got to the climax yet. Because now, we're going to be talking about DC Week. Yes, for all those who thought I was just biased towards Marvel. No, I'm not, because I do watch some DC. I like DC, I love it. But yes, DC Week, the invasion angle. It was a 4-series crossover between Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, and the Legends of Tomorrow. And, well, thoughts from me, first of all. When I first heard this was happening, I thought, well, isn't this a bit soon? because I knew it was happening since Supergirl joined the CW network. But I thought it was a bit way too soon to bring these guys all together. I mean, I was just getting into all the separate stories from the separate shows. But yeah, when you first heard about it, what did you think, Ryan?
I mean, like, I get what they were going for. Yeah, I thought they'd wait a little longer to kind of put them all together. But in the end, it worked out. I loved the 4-episode crossover. And, you know, it, like, I mean, like, I didn't love it, but, like, I liked what they were going for. The story itself, I don't know, kind of seemed bland to me with the whole aliens thing.
Yeah, the story kind of seemed forced.
Yeah.
But, like I said, they didn't have to force it. Per se. I mean, what I originally thought they were going for was, you know, that storyline with Supergirl and Cadmus. I thought they'd all come together to fight Cadmus, but of course the Cadmus storyline finished before the invasion crossover. So the invasion, it was a comic book storyline, but in the TV universe, it seemed kind of forced to happen on DC Week. And yeah, first note is the team getting together. Did you think the team getting together was a cool bit? Did you think it was, well, any team getting together, like the Avengers or something like that, that was smooth? Did you think the team getting together was smooth in this case?
Yeah, I thought it was smooth. It definitely could have been smoother. But it was smooth enough for me to enjoy them joining together as a team, considering, like, the conflicting personas from each, well, everybody on the team. You have, you know, Mick, Kid Flash, Supergirl, Arrow, Felicity, Cisco, fucking so many people.
So many people.
Yeah, but we got the 2 hours just naming them, jeez.
Yeah, no, but credit where credit is due. I mean, I think they did it really well, to be honest. The team getting together, I mean, the only thing I enjoyed about it was really Supergirl's inclusion, because that inclusion happened first on Supergirl. So, you know, Supergirl's on the Monday, Flash is on the Tuesday, Arrow's on the Wednesday, Legends is on the Thursday. So I liked how Supergirl, on the episode of Supergirl, that whole storyline happened. Supergirl's whole storyline happened. And then at the end of the episode, Flash and Cisco came. They vibed to the other universe and said, "Well, we need your help. You know that favor I asked for? We need it now." I liked that bit of it. The team getting together. Maybe not so with the Legends. I think that was kind of forced. But in terms of Arrow, well, the Flash and Arrow getting together, that's normal. Even if it's forced, and I don't mind it as such, because it's the Flarrow universe.
Yeah.
And yeah, the next topic is the first fight scene, when the aliens were controlling everybody else except Flash and Green Arrow. Did you enjoy it?
I mean, like I said, I thought it was dragged out, the story itself. But, I mean, I got what they were going for. I thought, like, I know they had, they had everyone except Flash, Arrow, and Kid Flash, right, under their control?
Yeah, but, I think Kid Flash wasn't really Kid Flash, he was still Wally West.
Yeah.
But he had speed at the time. And
so, like, I mean, in terms of that, like, I think they just, like, I would have kind of dragged it out a bit more. I don't know if that's just me, because I thought, like, I don't know, I felt like it was just too quick, like, the story itself. And I know they were trying to keep it in one episode, but, like, I don't know, it just seemed forced to me, like you said.
Yeah, it was way too quick. I mean, what I would have liked to happen was, I didn't want everybody else to get controlled. I just wanted, like, Supergirl to get controlled by the aliens, because she was really the main threat. She was the alien. She was the one that no one had ever heard of, and she was the most OP out of the group.
And yeah, that's true.
To see the Legends, Green Arrow, Flash, everyone going against Supergirl, that would have been cool. And especially those early doubts from, I think it was Oliver, that said, we can't really trust you. And also, when he said, to fight against this invasion, we need to practice against Supergirl. And that would have been a nice, like, you were training then, but now, it's the real thing. So, that would have been a nice thing to see. But they went with this. I thought it was alright. But like you said, it was a bit too quick. I mean, we went from Supergirl on the Monday. That wasn't a crossover episode. Then the Flash on the Tuesday, which was the first proper crossover episode. And we got that way too quick.
Yeah. Like, they could have developed a bit more, especially considering, like, you know, with Supergirl, she just ended Cadmus. So I think they could have started it there, like the whole alien coming to Earth thing, and they could have dragged it out a bit more to make it seem reasonable. I mean, if you're bringing all four of these, you know, teams and guys and girls together, you want to make it feel special. And the fact, I feel like they were just like, oh, we need to put it together quick so more people are invested. So they just, you know, threw it in all together and kind of hope for the best, which I think was a bad way to go for it. I think they could have done it a lot better.
Yeah. And now it's in the same topic of DC Week, but it's in a little subtopic of its own. Because this week we had the 100th episode of Arrow. And to be real honest with you, it didn't feel like it was the 100th episode of Arrow.
Yeah, I actually didn't even know it was a 100th episode of Arrow until you brought it up right now. I thought it was just a regular episode.
I knew from, like, promotional stuff and it was the 100th episode, but after that god-awful season 4, that went so quick.
Yeah.
Where it went so slow at the time, but really 100 episodes? After that horrible season 4? 100 episodes. Whoa. Just a congrats to Arrow, but that episode, it didn't feel special at all. And it felt like a little tease. A tease of everything that happened in season 4. Laurel still being alive. I mean, why they killed her off in the first place, I don't know. I don't know why. I think it just killed the show.
Yeah, I mean, like, honestly, I have no words. They could have done it a lot better. The fact that it was the 100th episode and people didn't know that it was, you know, it's sad in a way.
Yeah, it's sad. And the whole meaning behind the episode was Oliver, Sarah, and the rest of them were looking for justification, like, just to say one more goodbye to Laurel and all the characters that had died previously. And it's like, we've gone through the same thing that we went through for, like, the whole season. All the episodes after Laurel died in season 4, and even some episodes in season 5, all those topics were just in Arrow 100. They just recycled the same thing.
Yeah, they did, and I mean, like, it was just, I have no words, honestly. It was just, could have been better.
But one thing to note, Tommy's crush on Fia was looked at in the flashback, or the alternate universe, per se, and I've got this theory in my head that the new character Prometheus in Arrow is actually Tommy Merlin. I don't I don't know why. I just think, you know, they're trying to bring back old stuff that used to work. Like, Tommy, all that. All season one worked. Season two worked as well. That's why they brought it back Deathstroke for a bit. So I think Tommy Merlin is Prometheus. I don't know. Might not be.
I definitely agree with you there. I know, like, I had my own suspicions that Tommy was Prometheus. But, like, I mean, the fact that they are bringing back old characters shows that they know they've messed up in a way, and yeah, they're trying to fix it. Like, I don't know, like, we'll see how it plays out in the future, but right now, like, Arrow itself is, it's like, it's definitely in a bad place, not as bad as it was in the past season, but, like, they're getting better, and hopefully they do get out of this ditch and, you know, progress as a TV series.
Yeah, especially Season 5. Season 5, as before Arrow 100s, it was kind of getting me back into Arrow, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. But, same here.
But because of that theory of Tommy being Prometheus, one thing to watch out for is Prometheus going after Thea in the real world, because if that happens, then we could possibly just confirm that Prometheus is Tommy, because that was his crush a long time ago. So if Prometheus goes after Thea after killing all those people, I think you'll know that it's Tommy. And I was going to talk about the Arrow fight scene in Arrow 100, but what's the point? I think I've kind of demotivated Ryan right now by talking about it.
But it was demoralizing.
Yeah, demoralizing. Definitely the word. So yeah, let's get back to the actual DC week. And let's move on to the Legends of Tomorrow episodes of the invasion, I guess. And, well, the first thing that comes to mind is why the aliens invaded in the first place. And I thought this was a really smart, really, really smart idea. I'm not gonna lie. Credit where credit is due, but the whole reason they were there was because of Flashpoint. And because, well, Barry broke the truce the aliens had with the humans, and Flashpoint was the reason why this whole thing happened, and all the aliens wanted was Barry. And I thought that was good in some aspects.
Yeah, it definitely played out well, and I love how they're using Flashpoint to justify a lot of the changes, because I know, like, ever since, like, especially with Arrow, like, all of the, like, the terrible season that they just had, and all of the changes that are coming, and especially in the other TV series too, like, they're using Flashpoint to justify these changes, and hopefully, like, with these changes, like, the shows progressively get better. So, I mean, like, I love that they use the Flashpoint to introduce these aliens and the storyline and the truce and everything. I thought it worked perfectly, and I mean, like, if we're talking about the crossovers, I thought that was, like, Flashpoint was the best part of it all, because Flashpoint just kind of pieced it all together.
Yeah. Shame Flashpoint couldn't save Laurel, but
yeah,
that's a conversation for another day.
Yep.
And also,
you there?
Yeah, I'm there. I'm gonna have to edit that out.
Alright.
Yeah. Yeah, one smart... Well, another thing to do with Flashpoint was also the message that originally Captain Hunter got, but I've forgotten their names. I've actually forgotten
their names.
Dr. Stein. And that other guy found
Firestorm.
Well, they're both called Firestorm. We're just calling Firestorm.
Yeah.
Firestorm. Got. Which Firestorm got, And yeah, that is connected to Flashpoint as well.
Yeah. And I love how like they use that, like they built up to it, because you had the message come, like you, they've had the message for quite some time now, and they've kind of been, like in terms of, like, you know how I said that they kind of rushed to this, like out of all of this, this was the only aspect of it that was actually built up. This message that Barry sent from the future to the Legends, and the fact that they introduced it and played it into this storyline, and hopefully into future storylines, just, you know, makes me kind of happy that they did put some thought and consideration into this.
Yeah, so Flashpoint was the whole reason why this thing in 2069, I think it is, happens in the first place. And, well, a little Easter egg, that was the same date which the newspaper article in the old Reverse Flash's room, that's when it occurred, when Flash went missing. And the author of that article isn't Iris West Allen anymore.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty cool, considering like what happened in The Flash, and, well, not like after the whole crossover, the episode of Flash, with what happened with her. I thought it played out really well. Like, they have visions for the future, and it'll be fun to see, especially with, you know, they've got the god of, you know, speed coming up here, and it'll be fun to see how it pans out, especially you had what's his name, Julian, play alchemy, and he didn't even know he was playing alchemy. I thought that was pretty smart to keep him there as, you know, a good guy. Like, I still have my suspicions that, you know, he's still a bad guy. Like, near the end, I feel like he'll be the reason that she gets killed, Iris gets killed.
Yeah. Wait, was that Julian, Draco Malfoy?
Yes.
Character? Well, I'm sorry to say, but I haven't even seen that episode yet. But it's fine, I'll take the spoiler. It's not big of a deal.
Yeah. But that's my fault. I should ask. Jeez.
It's fine. Well, at least we've told the audience. We'll get to, well, we'll both get to this week's, well, no, last week's episodes of Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, Legends in the next episode. But one point to add as well, the next edition is Cisco, of course, angry at Barry for changing, for making Flashpoint. And in Flashpoint, his cousin died. Or brother. His brother died because of it. And Cisco did exactly the same thing Barry did by messing up time. And I think that was noteworthy, because that was interesting, and it got Cisco and Barry to be friends again, I guess, because Cisco made the same mistake Barry did. Cisco criticizing Barry for making a mistake, and he goes and does the same one.
Yeah. It's interesting. I thought it was pretty funny. It was just a big F you to Cisco, like, you know, you shouldn't be giving him crap for messing up when you just did the same thing. And I know, like, I feel like he did it twice in a way, because the one that stood out to me the most was when he opened the You see, like, I keep going back to this episode, and then I remember you haven't seen it. All right, we'll talk about the next episode. But, like, not a spoiler, but he does it again.
All right.
He messes up again.
But, yeah, not the last point, but next note is the final battle, the conclusion to everything. And, yeah, did you enjoy this bit? Did it satisfy you?
It could have been better. Definitely could have been better. I feel like it was too quick. They could have, like we've been saying, they could have dragged it out. And, like, I feel like that's the main problem here. Like, it was too quick.
Yeah. It was too quick. And I've just remembered the final battle, like, literally just this second. But, yeah, the way they beat the aliens in the first place, they put all those bombs on them. The Flash ran around putting all those bombs on each and every one. And to destroy them all of them had to have the bombs on them. I think that was a pretty weak way to destroy them all.
Yeah.
I mean, you have Supergirl. You have, like, probably the most OP superhero ever. Or the most OP superhero's cousin. Like, you could have been fighting for days, and you'd probably come out, you'd probably win. So, that was a pretty weak way to destroy all the aliens after all of that.
Yeah, and it was. And I mean, like you mentioned earlier, like, if they had kept Supergirl in their control for a longer time, maybe she could have been under their control now. So, I mean, like, if that was the case, then this could have worked. Like, they quickly got rid of all the smaller guys, and they had this big battle with Supergirl, where they ended up winning, getting her back, and, like, sending the aliens off back to wherever they came from.
Yeah. Yeah.
I feel like that would have made for a better story, especially considering, like, this is the first time they're getting together, so they have to kind of bond as a team and build up to the fact that they're all friends. The fact that that they all just came in and just like that, in a flash, no pun intended, they all became friends. It was kind of, like, it could have been done better.
Yeah, it definitely could. And after the battle was won and done, all the superheroes hung out, ate, drank, you know, partied. And one line from Ray Palmer really stood out when he looked at Supergirl, or Kara in her human form, and he was like, he said, "She really looks like my cousin." And this is pretty interesting. This is actually a really good Easter egg, because I noticed that Ray Palmer's actor, Brandon Routh, played
Superman
in that really awful Superman movie.
Oh, Jesus.
But it was a nice little nod to it. I mean, of course, Superman being the cousin of Supergirl, it was a nice little Easter egg to Superman Returns.
Yeah. I mean, like, it fit. It kind of reminded me of, you know, how Deadpool and Deadpool just kind of bashes Green Lantern every, like, a lot in the movies, and, like, on Twitter as well.
Yeah.
So I felt like it was a fun way to kind of do that here, with Palmer saying, "She really looks like my cousin."
Yeah. And the second to last point on the board was, which of the crossover episodes was the best? I mean, we've already established it was kind of rushed and they could have done better, but out of Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, Legends, which one was actually the best?
I'm gonna have to tie it with Flash and Legends.
Fair enough.
Maybe throw Supergirl in there too, just definitely not Arrow.
Definitely not Arrow.
Definitely not.
Well, I'd have to say Legends, just because, well, it was the final battle. It had more of the crossover bits in it. I mean, the Flash did, but it didn't really. It started the whole thing, so there was no really conclusion in that. And there was that they could have done better with the Flash and Green Arrow versus everyone else. So I have to say Legends, just because it finished it off, and also all the Legends appeared in that one. I didn't like the exclusion of, you know, Vixen and Steel. Right. So I'd have to say Legends. And
alright, I agree with you there.
The final points, the final question, the final noteworthy thing, was it good?
I mean, like, we've kind of answered this already in a way. Like, it could have been a lot better. They rushed it. But, I mean, like, it made for a good episode. I'll give it that. Like, it was enjoyable to watch. Looking back at it now, like, because I know, like, for everyone, like, the first time you watch something, you're kind of, you're blown away by it. And once you go back and look at it again, you see, like, the little flaws. And I know, like, that's what we do. Like, I take advanced TV and film in high school, and that's what we do. We look at old movies that we've already seen, and we nitpick certain parts here and there to see how it, like, how it actually was. So I felt like now that we're talking about it now, we can kind of nitpick the small or big, horrible parts of the show.
Yeah. It was definitely there was a lot to improve on there. I mean, like we've all said, it was rushed. I mean, we weren't expecting it. It was like, what, episode 6/7 of some series? And it was like, it was just before the mid-season finale, so it was too quick. It was way too fast. Just to squeeze it in there with DC Week. I mean, you could have done Easter eggs all week with the separate shows to show, yeah, right, it's DC Week. But you didn't have to have the big crossover now. Maybe after every show's concluded with their separate storylines, you could have done it. Or you could have put all the separate storylines and put them into one. So there was like one factor that put them all together. Like, you could have put Reverse Flash and Damian Dark storyline, the God of Speed, Prometheus, all of that could have been in the same boat, and that could have been the reason for the crossover. But they rushed it. They rushed it and put aliens in. That really was a rushed plotline in itself.
Yeah, I know, like, I feel like if you're gonna do a crossover with all these superheroes, you should, in a way, in a sense, have a crossover with all the villains as well.
Yeah. I mean, well, example being, you know, the Netflix series, the Marvel Netflix series. I mean, of course the Hand hasn't appeared in either Luke Cage or Jessica Jones, but they'll definitely be a big part in Iron Fist, and they have been in Daredevil. So you have that link, and also you have a link with, well, the Hand is linked with Daredevil and Iron Fist, and Luke Cage and Jessica Jones are linked in with each other as well, because they were sleeping with each other for the whole season of Jessica Jones, so...
That's true, yeah.
Basically, they're all linked.
Yeah, they are. And I like with the Netflix series, like, they do name drop, like, each other here and there, like, name drop Hell's Kitchen or Daredevil on an episode, like, on an episode of Jessica Jones, or Iron Fist on an episode of Luke Cage, and you have the Hand on Daredevil. Like, it's all building up to something big, and you can sense that. Like, with this, the DC crossover, they just, you know, woke up and went, oh, we should do the same thing, and just threw it all in, and it could have been a lot better.
And also, you could have had, you could have had, what's her name? Rosie O'Dawson, I'll just name the actress's name. You could have had that character. Well,
The nurse, yeah. I don't know
the equivalent of the character in, say, The Flash, Arrow, Legend, Supergirl. Could have had the same equivalent in that crossover. So they all, like, linked in. I mean, I know Legends, Arrow, and Flash in particular, they already link in. We've already seen all of those characters in each other's episodes. But Supergirl, he's really crossed over with just the Flash at one point.
Yeah.
But we could have seen someone link them all together. Like a Nick Fury.
Yeah, because I know, like, they've made it out to be that she's like in a different universe, so yeah. I get, like, they're not, like, pulling the trigger on, like, name dropping people and, like, making these partnerships, but like, they definitely could have found a way to squeeze it in there to make it, like, to build up to this in a better way.
But it was nice that Cisco made her that technology where she can jump universes.
Yeah,
thank God, we needed that. And yes, that's it for DC Week. All that's left to be said is, to ask is, well, what would you give the whole week out of, say, 10?
Alright, DC Week, I'm gonna have to give it either a 7.
A 7? Whoa.
Maybe a 7.5. I'll be generous. I'll give it a 7.5 or an 8.
I'll give it 7 out of 10. I mean, it wasn't bad. It wasn't
bad. It wasn't bad, but it could have been a lot better.
Yeah, it could have been a lot better. And it definitely wasn't DC Cinematic Universe bad.
Yeah.
So, yes. It was okay. And, well, it's not our last topic of the episode, but the two topics afterwards, we can splash through them. But this is our last big topic of the episode, of episode one. Doctor Strange, the last Marvel movie of 2016, the last superhero movie of 2016. A review, an informal review, should I say. And the first question of note, did you enjoy it?
I actually did. I thought Benedict played the character very well. I thought they, you know, for a first movie, I thought it panned out very well. And, you know, I thought it worked. I thought it was a good movie.
Yeah, I thought it was a good movie as well. I really enjoyed it. And I'm shocked that some people are saying, well, it was okay. It wasn't okay. It was good. It was brilliant. I mean, I understand overhyping and stuff like that, but yeah.
I mean, like, in terms of, because, like, I'm going into the film field, in terms of, like, the cinematography and the editing, I thought it was...
Yeah, I really thought it was good. I mean, the visuals were just tremendous. The visuals itself were just tremendous. The story, I think it was good. Yeah, the people. Well, some people say the story was just a normal Marvel structure. But if you really think about it, well, the whole story was based on time. And the Infinity Stone there was the Time Stone. But when, you know, Strange was saying to that one surgeon, cover up your watch, he didn't want to focus on time at that point. But when he was given that watch, well, when he had that watch from his love interest, the night nurse, when it broke, and Mordo came to save him, it cracked, and that meant it was a significant event at that point, because he'd just met Mordo, and he'd been in the whole world of, like, sorcerers and stuff like that. So yeah, it was a great change of pace. I liked the pace as well.
And it was very smooth, it played out well.
Yeah, and it was good for, like, it was one of the best, like, solo movies in the MCU.
Definitely.
And yeah, I enjoyed it. We've already answered the question of the story. Well, I just answered it. The characters. Did you have a favorite? Who was it and why?
I mean, like, I definitely thought Benedict playing Strange was a good fit for him. I think he plays the character very, very well, and he complements the role. Besides him, I mean, like, right now, I feel like, oh, you had, what's his name, Hong or Wong?
Yeah, Wong.
Well, I loved him too, because he was like a comedic bit, like, because this movie, as much as it was serious, it was comedic as well, and I feel like all Marvel movies have that, which is a fun way to showcase a movie or showcase a character. You don't want to keep it all too serious, because that'll, you know, push away some of your audience, so you add some aspects of comedy into it, that way you can bring in both the serious fans and the comedic fans, so I thought it was a well-produced movie.
Yeah, definitely Benedict Cumberbatch as Doctor Strange was a standout. Wong was a standout as well as the comedy element of the movie. And I also liked Mordo. Now, I can't pronounce the actor's name, but he's been in a lot of stuff. Don't ask me to pronounce the actor's name, because I will just bury it to the ground.
I'm going to try Chiwetel Ejiofor.
I think that was
God
close.
Knows if that's right. I think it was close. God knows if that's right. If I messed it up, I apologize to the actor.
Yes, Mom. But
yeah, he played a prominent role in the film. You had the Ancient One as well as Caecilius.
The Ancient One was Tilda Swinton.
Yes.
But the one that, the villain, the one that turned on the good side of the Sorcerer Supreme was Caecilius. Yeah, the villain. Yep. Mads Mikkelsen, I think.
Yep.
Hopefully
it.
I didn't butcher it. But yes, that was interesting as well. It was kind of like, he's probably like a forgettable villain, I must say. But he's definitely no Malekith from For the Dark World.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think Mordo was standout as well. Great actor to play him. And I'm interested for the future.
Yeah, same here, definitely.
And yeah, best moments, do you have any?
I'm gonna say the battle in the streets with the bad guys and the good guys, where they were kind of tipping and turning all the buildings left and right and upside down, and like they were going through walls and windows and everything was in the air. And I love the fact that they incorporate in the fact that like other people didn't know what was going on, and they kind of felt like they made it seem like they were in their own world, which they technically were. So I thought that was pretty cool. While these guys were just flying around, you know, wearing robes and such. And I like the fact that, like, every time, like, they were brought back, and I'm air quoting right now, into the real world, you know, people were looking at them like, the hell is going, why is he wearing a robe, why is she bald, you know, this and that, especially with the Ancient One. I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, my best moment has to be the fight scene, the fight scene in the hospital with Doctor Strange and his, like, soul with that other villain-type person, soul.
The goon.
Yeah, that was pretty, like, original and never been done in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Like, a fight scene like that, it was interesting to see. Great visuals as well.
Yeah, it was fresh, it was new, and, I mean, hopefully we'll see it in the future as well, especially with Infinity War coming up. We'll probably see it there. Besides that, I like the end fight with, I forgot his name, the main villain.
Oh, what the, wait.
It's on the tip of my tongue, I just can't remember right now.
I'm on the Wikipedia page. I'm on the Wikipedia page. Okay, I'm nearly... Dormammu,
there you go, that's... I've liked the scene with him, especially the fact that he, you know, looped time and kind of used that to his advantage. I thought that was as funny as it was smart for him to kind of get a one-up on Dormammu and use that to win the fight. Kind of lose the fight so many times to actually end up winning the fight. Like, it's confusing in a way where, like, it's fun. Like, you want to watch it again and you want to watch it over and over again. Like Dormammu was forced to in the movie. Yeah, I thought it was well edited, the fact that he lost so many times when in a way he was winning every time. I thought that was smart, it was funny, it was well edited, it kind of brought all aspects of the film together and brought I don't know anyone who didn't enjoy that scene.
Yeah, that was a cool scene, an original scene for a Marvel film, the complaint around town is, the same ending, the same happy ending, the same character demise. Like, I thought the ending in Civil War was quite new and fresh for a villain, and this one took it to a new level. I mean, I thought, all the characters, Mordo and Wong, thought he was running away, but really he was using his mind. He went to Dormammu, of course, he said, I've come here to bargain, and then Dormammu said, just killed him off the spot, and with a little trickery, with the time Infinity Stone, he came back and it was on an infinite loop. And he just annoyed Dormammu until he said, you know what? I don't want Earth anymore. You can have it. I don't care. So it's like, oh, well, it was a funny ending and it was a cool one. It was like, you don't always need to have violence to, you know, you don't always need violence to win an argument or to save the world. You can just do it through pure smart, pure genius and pure thinking. And it really says a lot about Doctor Strange's character, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. And is that the final topic we have here? No, it isn't. The future. Strange's... Well, first of all, we've got to talk about the post-credit scenes before we talk about the future. What did you think of the first mid... Well, the mid-credit scene with Thor and Doctor Strange?
I enjoyed it. I thought it worked, especially considering, like, this was used to introduce the fact that Strange will be appearing in Ragnarok. I thought it was a smart way to do it. And I thought it was a fun way to do it, too. It worked, like, the two characters complement each other. You have, like, you have Strange, who's a narcissistic prick, and then you have Thor, who's, like, all big and powerful, but he's kind of gullible in a way, too. So I thought, like, it worked out, in a sense.
Yeah, it definitely did. I mean, I like Thor's first words. It's like, now we have wizards on Earth now. And it was just a fun way to introduce Thor to the world of Doctor Strange, to the world entirely. And it's just like the mid-credits scene in Ant-Man, you know, because that mid-credits scene was originally a scene in Civil War. So I think that scene, which was the mid-credits scene in Doctor Strange, is a scene from Thor Ragnarok. And it'll probably happen in the middle of the movie. Obviously, the plot of Thor Ragnarok has been, well, confirmed, really. They're trying to find Thor's father, and he went missing in Thor the Dark World, I think, because Loki used his trickery to look like him. We don't know where he is. But it's nice as well that Doctor Strange has, like, a list of people that are, like, dangerous to the world, and Loki's on that list. So it just connects everything. It connects the fact that Doctor Strange, it's a Marvel movie. Everything we thought is Benedict Cumberbatch is actually in a Marvel movie. We're not playing with you. He's actually part of the MCU.
I mean, like, it works too, because, I mean, like, I know with, like, Thor Ragnarok, they'll probably link that to Infinity War, and that's the thing I love, because, like, with the DC movies, like, they're just all out of place in a way. With the Marvel movies, like, they link it together in a way where you feel like it's a big, happy family. And, you know, that's the way to go, and that's how it works, especially with this movie coming up, Thor Ragnarok. And with Doctor Strange and Spider-Man Homecoming, Civil War, so many of the movies.
Yeah. Well, I hate to break it to you, but we can both rant and rave all we want on the second episode, on probably like the final episode of 2016. I know it's weird, the final episode of 2016, but we just started.
Yeah.
But yes, we can talk about that in the next episode, which I can't wait for already. But yes, you're right. It's all linking together. And also, Doctor Strange, I think the timeline of it, the timeline, I thought, was originally, like, before the whole incident, during the whole incident, but I think it's after Civil War. I think it was made clear in the movie when the movie showed one of his prizes and it said 2016. So I think it is set after Civil War. Civil War, or even during Civil War. I don't even know.
But, I mean, like, if anything, they'll add it in as flashbacks, like, oh, this happened, and then they'll use that to link it to, Infinity War.
Yeah, there was a nice little Easter egg, which I thought was to do with Civil War, but it was confirmed it wasn't, about like a soldier testing out a suit, and he's paralyzed from the waist down. I thought that was Rhodey, but it wasn't. But there was a nice little Easter egg that probably is Captain Marvel related, about the lightning hitting the woman's brain or something like that. And I think that is a little Easter egg to Captain Marvel. Might be. But when the director was asked about that question, he just like said, he said no comment. So.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it'll. Like, we'll see when it comes out, how it pans out, and we'll talk about it definitely in a future episode.
And there was a post-credit scene. Now we have a mid-credits and post-credit scene in every Marvel movie. And the post-credit scene is probably always about the actual sequel to the movie. And in this, in the Doctor Strange post-credit scene, we got a hint at we got a look at Baron... Wait, at Karl Mordo. It's called Baron before. Karl Mordo. And we looked at him. We saw Jonathan Pangborn. He was a paraplegic who originally told Strange to go to see the Ancient One. And he was a paraplegic who healed himself under the sorcery. But Mordo went to Pangborn and removed his sorcery from him and made him paraplegic again. And Mordo's just said at the end of the movie, "I think I know what's wrong with the world. Too many sorcerers." And that is, of course, where he turns bad and turns into the villain we all know from the comics and the TV series. And yeah, that is a hint to the sequel. What did you think of that?
I actually didn't see that. Talking about it now, I'm gonna have to watch that later on. But from what you're telling me, the fact that they introduced Baron and, you know, set up for the sequel, I thought it was a brilliant way to do it. I'm definitely gonna have to go back and watch it. But the fact that they're bringing him back as a villain, I think that's a smart move, especially considering how disjointed he was and how far away he wanted to get from Strange. Mm. I think it works. I think it was a smart way to do that, to introduce him as a bad guy instead of a good guy.
Yeah, and also we know why he's turned bad, because it was revealed in the movie that the Ancient One used some of the Dark Dimension's powers for her own power, and you think that's wrong. So now he's going to go on a quest to remove any sorcerer's powers, I guess. And I think a smart way to do it is for him not to be the villain in Doctor Strange 2, but to be the villain in maybe a Doctor Strange 3. To when he's... Because Doctor Strange is the Sorcerer Supreme at the moment. So no way can Mordo go one-on-one with Doctor Strange. But if he gets so many sorcerer's powers, then maybe he could, you know, go head to head with Doctor Strange in like a third movie of like a trilogy. So I think that would be really cool to see. I guess two of the most amazing actors on the planet, in my opinion, and they're going one on one in the MCU. I think that's all a sight we'd like to see.
Yeah, that would definitely work. Yep.
And yeah, the final thing for the review of Doctor Strange is, what would you give the movie out of 10?
Out of 10, let's see, I'll probably give it a 9.
A 9? Interesting.
Putting it high up there, yeah.
You have a reason?
I just enjoyed the movie, story-wise and, you know, cinematography-wise, editing-wise, I thought it fit together well. I thought it pieced together. It sent a clear message that they're keeping Strange in the MCU, and they're introducing him as a major part of the cast of the whole universe. And I thought, like, the movie was a great way to do it.
Yeah, I would probably go the same route, and I would say a 9. From when I first saw it, I said 10 out of 10, 10 out of 10, 10 out of 10. But I think that's from every Marvel movie I see. I always come out and I say 10 out of 10, 10 out of 10, 10 out of 10. Yeah. Until a little hindsight, I watched it again the next day and I thought, okay, it's not a 10 out of 10. A 10 out of 10 is probably like a Civil War or a Dark Knight. So it's probably a 9 out of 10. It was really good, but it wasn't that good. So yeah, I enjoyed it. And especially with the time and yeah, everything I just told you about the time and the plot, about him covering up the watch. Strange didn't like time at first, but then afterwards, at the end, he embraced time, and it was such a heroic act. It's like he'd carry on the pain of getting killed infinite a number of times just to save the world from any more danger, which just spoke volumes. And yeah, excuse me, I think the movie was great, 9 out of 10. I loved it, and it should be pretty interesting come episode 2 when we have to rank every superhero film of 2016.
Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, we'll see how far that ranks up in terms of movies and, well, doing TV shows as well, or is it just movies?
Just movies. We can if we want TV shows.
Yeah, we'll see. I'm gonna have to make up that list, but right now I'd probably put Doctor Strange up there as one of the better movies of 2016 in terms of superheroes.
And yeah, just to say, when we talk about rankings, well, we'll probably do a movie ranking and then a TV series ranking, maybe even a net, because they're not part of the same branch, maybe even on its own a Netflix ranking, even though that wouldn't make sense, there's just two, but probably for that we'll do everyone so far. Sounds fair?
Yeah, that sounds fair. I think that could work.
Yeah, so three individual rankings, and also, what was I gonna say, and we'll do our own individual ones, so it's not like we're doing it as a branch. Like, our list will probably be different to one another's. And we'll get that whole feeling of, that was an interesting choice. I got this one. Just like a WWE draft. But better.
Yeah, I feel like that could work, yep.
Yeah, and now that's it for all of the Marvel movies and TV series. Now we're going to go on to a different topic. And that's gaming. Yeah, I know. It's been quite a busy week for gaming for Marvel. And first story to come out is... I titled that so wrong. No. Well, first story there. Guardians of the Galaxy, the Telltale series. I think... Have you played Batman, the Telltale series?
I haven't, but I've seen videos, and I get what the hype is about. I definitely want to start playing it soon. It seems like a fun game, especially considering, like, you have Batman's life and choices in your hand.
Yes.
I didn't know they were making one for
they're making
Marvel vs. Cap for Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah. Have you played any other Telltale games? Just a question.
I actually haven't. No, I haven't. I didn't even know what they were until I saw some videos on the Batman ones. And ever since then, like, I've been addicted, trying to find, like, a way to play it, or trying to find it for the PC so I can play it on my laptop.
Yeah, it is really addictive. I mean, the Walking Dead Telltale series game. Oh my. It doesn't follow the TV series, but it follows the comics. But you'll get into it. And, whoa, that's an emotional roller coaster. The Wolf Among Us is a good one as well. Batman, I'm playing it right now. I still need to play episode 4 and then 5 when it comes out. But, yes, Guardians of the Galaxy, the Telltale series, is coming out. And it just, proves that, you know, Telltale can, you know, go between the different sides. I mean, they just did the DC one. I was never expecting them to do a Marvel one. I thought, oh, they're doing Batman, they're doing a DC one, so if they're gonna do any other superhero ones, it'll probably be DC. Even The Wolf Among Us was based on, like, a DC comic. And a separate DC comic, I guess. And, well, they can go between the branches, and I'm looking forward to if they do a Daredevil Telltale series, because that will probably be the most interesting one.
Yeah, they probably will, considering how, like, much Daredevil, how far Daredevil has come based off the Netflix series, because before that, the only memory people have of Daredevil was the movie with Affleck and Jennifer Garner, I think it was?
Yeah, Jennifer Garner.
His ex-wife. That was so long ago. I mean, like, looking back at it now, like, the first time I saw that movie, I was invested. I was like, oh my god, Daredevil, this guy is badass. This movie is so good. And then looking, like, I saw the movie again, like, I don't know, I think it was a couple of months ago. And I watched the movie through, and I was like, Jesus, how big of an idiot was I as a kid?
I think, I've talked to my friend about this as well. We all shared the same thing when we were kids. We were like, oh my god, this is the best movie ever. And then when we grew up, we were like, well, with me, it's a nostalgic movie. It's the one movie that got me, like, a big fan of Daredevil. So I'll always, I'll always hold it in a special place. But the movie itself, it was...
It could have been better.
It could have been so much more better. But, yeah. Daredevil Telltale series. Flash Telltale series. Arrow Telltale series. The opportunities are endless.
Right,
that has been episode 1 of our Untitled Superhero Podcast. I'd like to say thank you to Ryan for being a co-host.
No problem, man.
And we will see you for episode 2. We missed out on Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite, but you know, we don't need to
talk about it the next episode, yeah.
The hype's already there.
Yep.
So yeah, look forward to episode 2. The CW show's mid-season finales, we'll talk about our individual superhero rankings of 2016, some Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite information, and that has been all. Ryan, would you like to say bye?
Bye, guys.
And it's goodbye from me. I hope you enjoyed. Don't be a Batman v Superman. Be a Captain America Civil War. And we will see you in the next episode.
Bye, guys.
Boy. Done.
Alright.
Alright, cool.
That's actually pretty fun. Ryan and Jay, we be running up a podcast. Look outside, we be changing up the forecast. Yada, yada, yada. All right.